Welcome to GC360, where news comes full circle. I'm Deanne Hamilton.
And I'm Michael Warwick. On today's episode of GC360, Georgia College students gather to bag meals for needy Baldwin families.
Then it's a fight to the death in the form of words.
And we'll check out this year's newest version of GC's literary journal.
All that and more on this edition of GC360. We began with the arrest of a Baldwin County volunteer firefighter. Charlie Gardner was arrested in mid-April on 3 counts of criminal trespassing following allegations that he performed unauthorized in-home inspections, according to 13WMAZ News in Macon. The Baldwin County Fire Department posted updates via Facebook about the matter. The department thanked the Facebook community for helping them resolve the situation. Gardner has been released on bond pending further procedures in the case. Millsville may be a small city, but homelessness here is no small issue. GC360's Sarah Beck hits the streets to help understand the issue.
When walking in downtown Millsville, it is common to see homeless and impoverished individuals occupying the benches and sidewalks. This week, GC360 caught up with Lionel Timothy Bowen, or LT. LT was once homeless in Millsville, and he explained to us how he turned his life around.
River Jake helped me get back. Headed in the right direction, going to classes, a lot of stuff that I'd already known because I was raised in out of teen, AA, out of nine. I was pretty much raised in mental health.
LT explained that people in Millsville become homeless for a number of reasons, from low income to poor judgment.
In my case, it was a whole lot different. It was lost passion, didn't care about anything. Call it bipolar, you call it manic, you call it whatever you want to.
Nowadays, LT has been able to fix that problem. He currently teaches guitar lessons, and you can often see him play if you just take a walk downtown. According to the Georgia Department of Community Affairs, as of 2013, Baldwin County has an estimated number of 82 homeless people. Some counties offer assistance to these displaced individuals. However, Baldwin only offers a total of 12 beds throughout the county. This number was told from the amount of shelters available in the district. Organizations such as River's Edge, like LT mentioned, Cafe Central, and the Georgia War Veterans Home all assist our county's homeless people by providing them warm meals and sometimes jobs. This is Sarah Beck reporting for GC360.
An estimated 100 students descended on the Centennial Center on Saturday to package 50,000 meals for needy families around Millsville. Bobcats Against Hunger hosted the event, along with Feeding Children Everywhere. I was there to capture this inspiring event.
The second annual Hunger Project was held in the Centennial Center Sunday to benefit underprivileged members of the Baldwin County community. About 100 Georgia College students were there to package meals for those in need of food. For the entire 2-hour session, students stayed busy. Much like that of an assembly line, each person played a specific role at their table, no breaks allowed. But there was some fun. Music played, and there was plenty of friendly competition and smiling. We caught up with this volunteer, Paul McNeil, about his experience.
I was at a table with my team. I was there with my cross-country team, and most of the tables were all there with people they knew. And so that was kind of fun because when they started doing competitions throughout the experience, people, you know, started getting really competitive and started scooping as fast as they could, and you know, we got the job done really quickly and really efficiently.
The event was put on by the Bobcats Against Hunger with the help of nonprofit organization Feeding Children Everywhere. We spoke with founder and co-director of Bobcats Against Hunger, Mackenzie Fisher.
I think the event went really smoothly. All the students were very enthusiastic. I thought it was a great atmosphere full of competition, fun and music. And at the end of the day, 50,000 meals got packaged, so I think it was definitely a success.
Did you hear that? In 2 hours, Bobcats packed 50,000 meals. Drop that number on a volunteer, and they might be surprised.
Yeah, it sounds pretty mind-blowing. Never thought. It didn't even seem like, an enormous crowd for how many meals we packaged, so I thought we all did a pretty good job.
So let's walk you through the process. The meal being made was a lentil casserole. The four ingredients in each meal, rice, lentils, dried vegetables, and Himalayan salt, all thrown together in a bag. After being weighed to ensure consistency, the bags are sealed and put into a box. That box is taped up, then off they go, ready to be loaded on a truck and dispersed throughout Baldwin County. Put them in a boiling pot of water, heat it up, and you've got yourself a filling, nutritional meal, 50,000 of which are now on their way to the plates of in-need Baldwin County residents. For GC360, I'm Michael Warwick.
Michael, that was awesome. Can you tell us more about the Hunger Project?
I was there. I actually volunteered. I was there with the cross-country team. Most everybody knew the people they went there to volunteer with. So, you know, you'd be there with your friends at your respective table, and it kind of went as an assembly line. People would package meals. As I said, it was a lentil casserole, very simple, but as long as you did your role, you know, and you could whip out a meal in like 5 seconds if it went down the line. But really neat. I'm glad I could do it. I hope I can do it next year. 50,000 meals, that's something else. So
yeah,
really cool.
Well, that's awesome and certainly a humbling experience. Coming up next, we'll be featuring the GC Lacrosse Club team.
Don't go anywhere. We've got a sport that's all our own to show you.
Don't look at me. Your hair's a bit frizzy today.
Aww. You should pick that up.
Oh, you're such a dork.
Loser.
Here, let me help you with that.
Oops. Every day, kids witness bullying.
Oh, look. Your crush is looking at you.
Poor you.
They want to help, but don't know how.
See, no one here's going to help you, because no one
Teach your kids you. How to be more than a bystander. Visit stopbullying.gov.
If you drive buzzed, it could cost you around $10,000. You'll face major legal fees, major fines, and steep insurance penalties. You could lose everything. Buzzed, busted, and broke. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
What if you could invest in the future of kids, like a stock? Not the kind of stock that's about making money, but a stock for social change. A whole new kind of investment called Better Futures. When you invest, it helps kids go to college. Believe in us, invest in us, watch us grow.
My name is Sydney, and I'm your dividend.
When my thing comes up. I'm not first.
Welcome to GC360 Sports, live from front campus. I'm KJ Sinclair.
I'm Kelly Miller.
And I'm Cole Rogers. Let's get started. Club sports are quite popular among students here at GC. GC360's Jennifer Jacobs caught up with one of the club sports, the women's lacrosse team, to talk about their passion for the game and how it's different from other club sports here at Georgia College.
Georgia College, like many other universities, supports club teams, aside from the standard sports teams. The club teams are completely student-run, and they travel to compete with other schools. The Bobcat Women's Club lacrosse team is one of those. Headed by president and team captain Jordan Orlandi,
The women's team is open for all women interested in playing collegiate lacrosse. Orlandi came into the program with a passion for lacrosse and is eager to improve the program for the future.
Well, we were actually inactive last year, and then I started up again this year. So, honestly, before I started up, I don't know how long the team had been around.
With the number of women on the team increasing, the team is expanding and has seen the arrival of many new opportunities. They travel long distances and sometimes even out of state to compete against different colleges and various tournaments.
We played College of Charleston in Kennesaw, Georgia State, Samford, Florida Atlantic.
Traveling to Boca Raton, Florida was a great experience for the team. Getting used to the new conditions was a challenge, but the excitement was still the same.
A little change of climate. We weren't used to like the humidity and stuff, but it was good practice for us. We didn't win our game, but it was still fun.
With so much structural organization, the team is in good shape. Organized practices and learning the basic fundamentals of the game helped the team to perform well on the field. The responsibility falls solely on the players to get things done, and they perform at high levels, even without a coach.
We don't play with a coach either, which is actually really cool, because last semester we scrimmaged with a bunch of different colleges, and we had a bunch of people come up to us and say that they were really surprised by like the way that we played and our technique and stuff, because we don't have someone helping us out.
Traveling to other colleges and playing in tournaments around the nation is one highlight of being on the women's club lacrosse team. But can you catch them hosting any home games?
No.
This is Jennifer Jacobs reporting for GC360.
Bobcats on three. 1, 2, 3.
Bobcats!
Now, the event you've been waiting for all year, we're going to head to our epic hula hoop competition. Okay, so let's start by introducing our two teams. And you, sir, what is your name?
I'm Taka.
Hello, and what is your major?
Business.
Okay. And you, miss, what's your name?
My name is Bren.
Bren, nice to meet you. Are you excited?
Yeah, I'm so excited.
Good. What's your major?
My major is theater.
Awesome. All right, and you all know Cole. And what's your name?
Hi, I'm Rachel.
Hi, Rachel. What's your major?
Mass communications.
Awesome. Good major.
Sydney, and I'm also mass communications.
Cool. And KJ, any words?
I'm KJ.
Nice words. Okay, so we're going to start by explaining the rules here. It's going to be sort of a relay that we have going on here. Okay, so there's obviously three people on each team, and our anchors are going to be going last. But if we could have our first volunteers come forward with the hula hoop. Great, number one. All right, they're going to hula hoop until they drop it. And then once they drop it, the team member behind them is going to take it up and do it. And then after that, they're going to take it up and do it. And then the first person after 2 minutes wins. So, and I'm going to time this. Let me stand back here. Okay, are you guys ready?
Yep.
Let me pull up this timer. Let's see. Okay. Are you ready?
Yep.
Yes? Set? Go! And they're hula hooping. And they're really into it. And the hips are swiveling. And they're doing really great. Yes, there's some excitement, some confidence. They are both doing quite well. I'm very impressed with these. Doing very nice. And we're still going. You know? Okay. Clearly you guys are very, very good at this, so we're gonna try something else. Keep going. I would like you all to lift your right leg, please. Right leg's lifted. Oh, okay, keep going. And now the next person. Yep, just like her. Oh, here we go. Lift your leg up. There we go. Okay, next person, come on. No, it's all you. You can do it. Lift that leg up there. There we go. Lift your leg. Yes, you can. This is amazing. There's some sort of underground hula. KJ, your turn. Come on, step in there. Look, she's still got it. Still got it. Okay, so I'm gonna make this a little bit more difficult for you because clearly you're doing too well. So I'm gonna need you to lift both your arms over your head, please. Thank you. Down? No, you get another round. lift your leg high. Very nice. Okay, next person. you guys both, you gotta do, lift your arms up, legs out, next turn. Yes, hands up. One leg, hands up. You have a lot of confidence here, Cole. You got them. All right. You guys got 15 seconds. Come on. Okay. All right. Did you guys go through twice already or just once? Okay. All right. And that was your final two times? Okay. I think we have our winning team. Congratulations. This has been extremely exciting. All right. Now, can I get some words with you guys? How does it feel to be the reigning champions of the first ever Georgia College hula hoop competition? This is exciting.
So excited.
Honor of my life. Yep.
I think they need to put this on the refrigerators, ladies and gentlemen. This is exciting. Cole, any words?
I am so happy right now. This made my day, my whole week.
All right. And that's all we have. I'm Kelly Miller.
Jason Clare.
And I'm Cole Rogers, and we'll be right back for more GC360 News.
You make me wear my bike helmet.
Taught me never to run with scissors.
You tell me to stay away from drugs.
To always buckle my seatbelt.
And to follow the swimming rules.
You're always looking out for me and trying to keep me safe.
So why do you keep a loaded gun in your drawer?
Here in the garage.
Closet?
Shoebox under the bed.
Where anyone can get to it.
How safe is that?
How safe is that?
How safe is that?
You asked them to follow some safety rules. Now they're asking you. In fact, they're counting on you. Never let your gun get into the wrong hands. If you own a firearm and are not using it, please be responsible and be sure that it's stored in a safe place. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Thank you, dear. Well, you're very supple.
Just like I was at your age. Back then, I was a sex expert. Used to call me the buttered biscuit. I know about birth control, too. So you can ask me anything, baby.
Bedsider.org has birth control information and a lot more. And it's...
Have you had sex in this car yet?
This past year, the Hardy Telescope on the GC campus became accredited as an International Astronomical Union Minor Planet Center. I ventured to Hardy to find out more about this impressive accreditation.
Of two undergraduate students, Dr. Donovan Domingue tells us how the telescope became largely recognized.
They were able to observe an asteroid over two nights, several asteroids over two nights, and they submitted their measurements of where the asteroid was located, and that allowed the observatory to be recognized as an official observatory.
At the beginning of each semester, the telescope is open to the public for an observatory night. During this time, people are able to look through the telescope and see the heavens of that month.
Healthy foods and transportation are things we may take for granted, but for many they are hard to come by. Candace Chapel lives in an area known as an urban food desert. This is a place where at least 20% of the residents are below the poverty line and grocery markets are far away. Ms. Chapel does not have a job or a car, but she hopes things will get better. GC360's Jesper Hagel has her story.
Vegetables, meat, and bread. Items that most of us take for granted. For Miss Candace Chapel and her four children, they are literally miles away. Candace Chapel lives at Youngblood Road, just south of Milledgeville. an area that is classified by the U.S. Department of Agriculture as an urban food desert, a place where at least 20% of the households are under the poverty line, and where the nearest grocery store is further than a mile away for at least a third of the population, a place where there is low access to healthy and affordable food. For Candace Chapel, no job and no money means that she has to do without one of the most important things in America, a car.
Well, the coping with it is just aggravating. You know, you always have to call somebody, and then you never know their schedule and what they've planned for the day, and, you know, kind of just working around everybody else's schedule to get the things that you need done, and it's aggravating.
According to the USDA, 388 households south of Milledgeville do not have access to a car and are further than half a mile away from any grocery store. People are therefore forced to rely on family and friends to get what they need.
It kind of just makes me wishy-washy. Like, sometimes I don't want to call them. Kind of got a little bit too much pride. But then, you know, you have to think about your kids. It's whether you or them, you know, they need things. So I wash my pride aside, whatever. I just call, you know, whether they say yes or no, it's worth the try. You know, but like, sometimes I don't want to be bothered with people because they get on my nerves. Sometimes I want to be bothered with my mom. She get on my nerves too.
Well, sometimes once a week, whenever she need to go somewhere, because sometimes, you know, she have to go get the baby milk and stuff like that. And so I have to take her there, you know, and then like maybe once a month, sometimes she, you know, she go and get a grocery at Walmart and stuff like that. So I have to go and load them all up, the children and her, and I take her wherever she need to go, you know.
The closest grocery store for Candace Chapel is a small store called Johnny McDade Groceries at Winsome Highway, just about a mile away from the house. Miss Candace Dukes works at the store and meets a lot of people on foot.
A lot of people walk. Like, a lot of our customers, they live in the general area, and most of them don't have vehicles, so they do walk. We even have veterans that come up here in wheelchairs.
A few miles down Winsome Highway at Georgia College, Dr. Jim Lidstone works with health and social issues in the community, areas that are closely related to life in a food desert.
Well, I think that people that live in a food desert, again, have limited access to, you know, to healthy, affordable food. And if you have limited access, then you're not going to eat as well as you should. If you live in a neighborhood that, you know, typically neighborhoods that are food deserts are also neighborhoods that have issues related to crime and safety. And so if you live in that kind of a neighborhood, you're not as likely to get out and you know, walk or ride a bike or have your kids go out and play, things like that. So that combination of you know, lack of access to opportunities for to be physically active and a lack of access to healthy food you know, really makes you at risk for chronic disease.
Out of the refrigerator.
For Candace, shopping for food with four kids means she saves a lot of money buying food at the bigger supermarkets. But supermarkets are far away, and public transportation does not exist.
They had something local that didn't cost as much as a cab, you know, to go here and there, and something bigger, you know, for the ones that have excess kids, you know, that would be nice or whatever. So.
However, it wasn't always like this.
Well, it's actually, I mean, like, I did purchase that vehicle, but the vehicle needs a transmission. So therefore, we're not, you know, I don't have enough money to get the transmission fixed right now. So, you know, I'm working at it. It's just like, it's kind of hard. Being that we have to pay all the bills here. I have to pay the rent, the gas, the water, you know, the light bill, then the internet. So it's so many bills in one phone. So I can't put nothing back to work towards the car, because I try to struggle to get these bills paid, so. And I'm not working, so. I do hair here, so. Just, you know, do a little bit of odds and ends, do a little babysitting, look different things, make ends meet.
Yet 8 months without a vehicle, Candace still remains hopeful.
Like, I would never give up the faith or the hope that, you know, things will get better or whatever. And soon I'm going to just start back trying to go to work because, like, I had recently had a baby and she's 5 months now. So I think it's right to go ahead and get back in the work field. Just let her go to daycare, you know, pray for the best, you know. But I'm definitely going to get back on my feet as far as a ride. I'm not staying here that long. I'm just, you know, down and out right now, but I got hope that it'll get better.
Tuesday, April 28th, students gathered on GC's front campus to remember and honor chemistry major Lauren Ganey. Dozens of students, faculty, and staff filled front campus to honor and show their support for Ganey's family, who were also in attendance. The evening candlelight vigil was held at Ganey's favorite spot on campus, the rocking chairs at Parks Hall. Lauren Ganey passed away Monday, April 13th, from what university officials say was natural causes. Ganey was involved in a number of organizations at GC, but she worked most closely with the GC Chemistry Club, which organized the vigil. A representative from each of the organizations released balloons in her honor. The Chemistry Club also presented Ganey's family with a jar filled with notes and memories about her, something her family can cherish forever.
The International Club.
Online classes are a great thing, but do they take away from personal connections important in classroom learning? GC360's Sarah Beck spoke to students and faculty members about online classes.
Online classes at Georgia College are becoming more and more popular, but as a liberal arts university, GC prides itself with a strong classroom environment, an interaction between students and professors, an interaction that might disappear in the online classroom. Data shows that a total of 1,429 students are currently taking online classes through Georgia College. This is an increased number from previous years. So does GC feel that online classes help students succeed academically?
When I taught classes online, particularly the last class that I taught, what I did was I would post a controversial issue at the onset of the week. It could be an issue or it could have been a video, something that I knew that would generate discussion and that would have sort of varying opinions. And the students were required to post a comment in response to what they saw. And then another part of the class was recorded presentation, so students would do the presentations, record them, and upload them, and then other students in the class would have to offer them feedback on it. And so that gave students an opportunity to hear from each other as though they were in a traditional classroom setting, although it was online.
Both professors and students feel online courses can be beneficial if done correctly. Dr. Torrance shares with us how she keeps her online classes interactive.
But I think if students come in open-minded, I think that they'll get the most from the experience, but I don't think that it takes away from the liberal arts approach to education. It just requires a more creative approach to get the same results.
GC is offering over 150 online classes this summer, but they do not plan to expand their numbers of online classes in the near future. Student Mackenzie Hobbs told GC360 her thoughts on online classes.
For the two classes I've taken online, it's been great because the teachers are really interactive, and but it's more kind of like you learning. There's not much to explain, I guess.
In conclusion, online classes are not as interactive as being in a classroom, but they've proven to be successful for GC students. This is Sarah Beck reporting for GC360.
Coming up next, we're there for an intense death match.
A haiku death match, that is. The most intense literary competition hits Milledgeville and contestants are out for blood. We'll explain that and more after the break.
No more pencils, no more books.
No more teachers, dirty looks.
School's out for summer.
School's out forever.
School's out with fever.
School's out completely.
What this place needed was better graduation rates. So we worked with schools like Henry Ford High, and now they're up 18%. And it can happen in every place.
To help us do more good this year, go to unitedway.org because great things happen when we live united.
Here is my handle and here is my spell.
When I get all steamed up, then I shout.
Tip me over and pour me out. Oh.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Cheers.
Take time to be a dad today.
Welcome to GC360 Entertainment. I'm Veronica Ulisney. An entire web series produced by only 5 people? It may sound unrealistic, but it's being done as part of the multimedia storytelling class at Georgia College. The web series, The Final Remedy, finished its filming this week. The series is produced by Ashley Farrell, written by Emily Davis, filmed by Nikki Vandenhoek, with Alex Johnson handling the editing and Shelby Light managing PR. The series is a murder mystery with twists and turns that keep the audience guessing. The 5-person crew has released 6 episodes on YouTube so far. There are 2 other web series being produced in the multimedia storytelling class, Perry Hodder and The Back Infection. The final show of each web series will be shown Tuesday, May 5th at 9 a.m. below the Maxwell Student Union in the Donahue Lounge. It's a race to the finish with words. On Wednesday, April 22nd, Art as an Agent of Change held a poetic deathmatch competition. GC360's Dallas Yates has our story.
All right, Red Poet reads.
There are several thoughts that come across one's mind when someone mentions a haiku deathmatch. First and foremost, what is it? Essentially, this display of emotion is a poetic boxing match featuring the art of haikus, the odd number and unrhymed lines of poetry we were all forced to write in middle school. On Wednesday, April 22nd, Art as an Agent for Change held a Poetic Notions Haiku Death Match at Blackbird, where a total of 3 contestants competed for first place. Before the battle, haiku workshops were available to help poets train. The haikus varied from witty to empowering depending on the artist's style. In order to become victorious, the participants needed to prepare a 25 to 27 line haiku for their final competition. Each contestant views the art of poetry as different ways to express themselves, and they have a love for creating it.
We're showing people that you don't have to just do 575 and about nature. It's about having fun with it and just, you know, getting the crowd to laugh. But poetry in general is just an expression for me. It helps me work through things that I'm feeling, and I just think it's really fun, and I like doing it in a non-academic atmosphere.
Maybe what best sums up this unconventional outlet of expression is this small haiku displayed on the Art as a Change Facebook page. Haikus are easy, but sometimes they don't make sense. Refrigerator. This is Dallas Yates reporting for GC360.
Everyone has a creative side, and GC has a different way for students to churn out their artistic masterpieces. The Peacock's Feet is a literary journal that showcases the many sides of creative life at Georgia College. GC360's Alex Mason has a story on this year's edition.
Each student at Georgia College is creative in his or her own way. Every year, a journal entitled Peacock's Feet is published highlighting students' literary and artistic works. Over winter break, the Peacock's Feet staff reviews the submissions and chooses what will be presented in the book. This year, around 60 students from various majors made submissions. 20 student works were chosen. Allison Blanchard is an English major and also editor-in-chief of the Peacock's Feet.
The Peacock's Feet is a literary journal that encompasses many different aspects of Georgia College life, I like to think. It has music, art, and literary works from nonfiction to fiction and poetry that pretty much try to encompass like life at Georgia College.
This year's journal will be the 40th edition of the journal. It will be presented at the reception this Friday. The reception will be held downstairs at the campus bookstore. Talented musicians will perform, students will read from their work, and refreshments will be provided.
At the event, we're going to unveil the journals, and everyone can come and pick up a copy and pick up some music or listen to the music that's going to be online for people to listen to. Basically, there's going to be free food, and it's just going to be a fun time to just chat and flip through the journal. We're going to have the winners of music, art, poetry, and prose read and perform their pieces for art explained, you know, per piece.
It's
The journal features various types of writing, music, and art. In addition to the journal, the Peacock's Feet staff also host monthly readings at Blackbird for students to share their poetry. The journal is free to anyone who is interested in learning more. Pick up a copy around campus on Friday. This is Alex Mason reporting for GC360.
If you're looking for somewhere to let your inner nerd out, then we have some great news for you. The Student Government Association hosts a weekly trivia night at Amici's on Mondays at 10:30 p.m. Alex Mason also went to Amici's to check it out.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Amici's Trivia presented to you by the Student Government Association.
Every college student has a little nerd in them. Luckily, a local restaurant hosts a weekly trivia night to let people express their inner nerd. Every Monday night at 10:30, the Student Government Association hosts Trivia Night at Amici's. SGA composes questions in various categories for teams to answer. 10% of Amici's proceeds from Trivia Night benefit the Student Emergency Fund.
The Emergency Fund is made for students that are in dire need that have absolutely no way of affording anything, food or a place to live or anything like that.
Not only is Trivia Night benefiting a good cause, it is also a great social outing for students. Trivia Night is composed of three rounds. Each team must listen to the question and then write down their answer. After all questions are asked in the round, the correct answers are provided.
Granddad and grandma from his mom's side. That's where they originally.
For every round that is won by a team, Amici provides the winners with vouchers to use however they choose. It's safe to say that teams take winning very seriously.
Amici! We come almost every Monday. We're seniors now, and we're about to graduate in May. We've been coming for a couple years now. It's really fun.
School weeks can be highly stressful for students. Trivia is a relaxed Monday night with friends. Whether you are looking to show off your nerdy side or make memories with friends, trivia is always a fun option. This is Alex Mason reporting for GC360.
Coming up in GC360, Michael and Deanna will be back and we'll be looking at the graffiti scene in Milledgeville. Here's the question, is it vandalism or is it art? Stick around and we'll find out. We'll be right back.
My new mom and I have a lot in common.
The great outside.
We both love the outdoors.
So shiny.
That's not a flower. We both love geology.
Oh, look.
An igneous one.
That's not a rock.
And she knows a lot about wildlife.
A labradoodle.
That's not a dog.
Hanging out has been kind of fun.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are.
They said I couldn't dream. Called me a piece of trash and swore that's all I'd ever be. Said a bottle couldn't see the ocean. Give up. Go back to the dumpster. But I didn't listen. I made my way. And now, I am what I've always wanted to be.
Can you help me with this?
My new dad teaches me all kinds of stuff.
Sure.
He helps me with homework.
That would be 3.6795.
Thanks.
Yep.
He helps me with my decision making.
I wouldn't use this one. Ever.
And he's even teaching me how to drive.
And that's why cars have bumpers.
I'm learning so much.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are.
GC's Bobcat Thunder has a new look. That's all thanks to the work of one talented GC art student who won a contest, and with it, the right to have her work displayed on GC apparel sold at the campus bookstore. We've got Alex Mason again. She caught up with the artist of the now famous Artsy Bobcat.
Holding the title as a liberal arts university, Georgia College has many creative students. Georgia College graduate student Kelly Self is using her creativity for GC's benefit. Because she won GC's Alumni Art Show Contest, her artsy bobcat illustration is now featured on GC's apparel.
I wanted to do something that was sort of like related to the school, and the only abstract thing related to the school is, of course, the bobcat. So, and I couldn't do the exact bobcat because that's a copyrighted image, and so I like did sort of a rendition of it, sort of like Windows XP screensaver in addition to it.
Kelly spends her free time designing various graphics. She is dual majoring in art and psychology. However, her passion for art and design has been an important factor throughout her life. GC360 wanted to see the artsy bobcat in action, so we made a trip to the downtown Barnes & Noble bookstore. The artsy bobcat design is placed on Georgia College t-shirts, coffee mugs, and posters. Kelly's design has been a hit on campus. Students have noticed the new design on GC apparel and are seeing it as a new trend. Supervisor of Barnes & Noble, Susan Bergamy, has seen it all in her 16 years at GC, but notes that Kelly's design has definitely been a success.
Oh yeah, this is our second shipment of the t-shirts, so the shirts are going real good.
From designing GC's new clothing line to freelancing on her own, Kelly Self does it all. I'm Alex Mason reporting for GC360.
Police in Milledgeville don't go out of their way to arrest people for creating graffiti, but it is illegal and graffiti artists can face criminal charges. So is graffiti art or just reckless, destructive activity? GC360's Katie Souther took to the streets of Milledgeville to find out what people think.
Art or vandalism? Since the early 90s, graffiti has been a controversial topic in the United States. In Milledgeville, graffiti is not a high crime problem. Here, the majority of graffiti can be found underneath bridges or on decaying buildings. Major Davis with the Milledgeville Police Department shares his opinion on graffiti.
Some is certainly art. Some are far talented than I am at it. And it's amazing what they can do with spray paint. But I think that all has a time and place.
But why does someone create graffiti? In an off-camera interview, due to legal purposes, one of Milledgeville's more well-known graffiti artists by the tag name Nas explains why he creates graffiti, stating, "It's like an escape. If I'm upset or mad, it relieves my stress. And even when I'm happy, it's still great to paint." He smirked and further stated, "I guess I always love to paint. And when I'm finished, I feel complete." So what does Milledgeville think about graffiti? To find out, GC360 hit the streets to interview locals and students about their opinion.
I definitely think that graffiti is art, not vandalism.
Does some graffiti qualify as vandalism?
Not a big fan of text in anything, so I can see that as vandalism, depending on where it's coming from and the meaning behind it. But then again, it's subjective, so really, I mean, technically it's art to somebody, so I guess that makes it art.
GC student Emily McKevitt also agrees.
And I think it depends, but for the most part, I think graffiti is art.
Although this may not be the consensus for every Milledgeville resident, many agree that graffiti is a way of expressing emotion and not a way of committing a crime. So what do you think? Is it art or is it vandalism? The opinion is all yours. This is Katie Souther reporting for GC360.
That's it for our last regular show of the semester.
But we have a very special program planned for next week. On Tuesday, May 5th at 4 p.m., we'll host a debate with three candidates running for Milledgeville mayor. Businesswoman Melba Burrell, former Mayor Floyd Griffin, and businessman Gary Thrower.
The candidates running in the June 16th election will join in for a full hour debate. We're proud to be hosting this event on GC360, the only television news organization devoted to covering Milledgeville.
Please mark your calendars Tuesday at 4 p.m. on Channel 4 or Channel 180 for charter users and tune in for the debate.
That's it for us here at GC360 News. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We'll have some exclusive content on our internet platforms in the coming days. I'm Michael Warwick.
And I'm Deanna Hamilton. We'll see you on Tuesday for the Candidates Debate.